2 weeks ago, I preached on what love is not, so we're going to be a little more positive today. We're going to preach on what love is. Now, I won't be able to cover all of them in just a short time, but we're going to take a few of the things, what love is. And we have to look at God to see that He is definitely about love. He is also eternal, He is all-powerful, He is all-righteous, and He is just. But most of all, He is a God of love, and that's one of the first songs that we learn as children, is that Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And so we teach love to our children, and we have to remember His great love through His Son, Jesus Christ. And that's why we take communion every Sunday morning. It's the perfect time to concentrate on His tremendous love through the bread and through the cup. He loves and He keeps loving us no matter what. Because of this great truth about God, that He is love, we also have to look at the way that we were made. How are we made? We are made in the image of God, so that it is possible for us to love even the unlovable. Love the unlovable. That's not always easy to do, but we have that capacity because we are made in His image. It is no accident that our foremost responsibility to God is to respond with love to Him and to others. Sometimes it's not always easy, but He expects us even to love our enemies. And of course, we realize there's different kinds of love, and we're not going to explain all the different kinds of love, but I've already mentioned about the agape love, and that agape love is perfectly performed on the cross when He died for every one of our sins. As we look in the dictionary, maybe Webster's dictionary, we have a definition of love, and it's a lot different than the Christian love that is expected of us. As I looked into the dictionary, we see that is defined by the art of affection. That's one of the descriptions of love. It is also a very sympathetic love. Also in Webster's dictionary, it talks about love being tender and a passionate affection for one of the opposite sex, and also being very benevolent as well. But as we look at the scriptures, we see a different approach to love. It's a moral love to God. It is also a spirit of unbreakable God's will for others. It's also an unflinching desire to have constructive action on behalf of those who are loved. And as I said, we're supposed to even be able to be kind and to love our enemies, which is not always easy to do, but that is what God expects of us. We have to remember, we're not perfect either. And when we ask God to forgive us, He forgives us. And for us to hold grudges of those who are our enemies, that will only make us bitter. And we know that you have seen people that are very unforgiving, and they're not easy people to be around. It's so much easier if we forget and forgive and go on rather than to hold that grudge. God expects us of that. That is the God's love, and He expects the same love from us, that we forgive and go on. As we look at these scriptures, it talks about faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. We have to realize that it is greater than eloquence, the love of God. It is also greater than intellectual achievement. It is also, as we have mentioned already, faith and hope. It's stronger than that. And even martyrdom. If we not have love, even being martyred for a cause, if we have love, do not have love, it profiteth us nothing. It is a love that really counts in human relationship, for it is the great helper, it's the great healer, and is the great teacher of life, this thing called love. It is interesting to note in 1 Corinthians 13 that you can substitute the name of Jesus in 1 Corinthians 13 with Jesus, and it's the perfect definition of Jesus. So, and our goal is that someday We can substitute our name every time the word love is mentioned, and that will be a description of us. And so that is our goal in the Christian life, to have that definition of love within our own lives. Now, let's define love. Just take a few of the examples of what love is. First one I want to talk about is that love is patient. Jesus is patient at all times. Love suffers long. We live in a day that impatience is the way of life. Now, when's the last time that you've gone to a restaurant and it took forever to get your food? Now, pretty soon, you know, after about a half hour, we start, you know, doing a little grumbling. Where's our food? I mean, I ordered a hamburger. They have to go out and kill a calf to get it. I mean, that's what we think about. Sometimes our store clerks, have you ever been in line and just have to wait and wait and wait? Now, Linda, we love Walmart, but at Christmas time, sometimes it's a long wait, and we get very impatient when it comes to a clerk that is very, very slow. Also, family members, sometimes we get impatient with our family members when they do something wrong, continual, just tries to straight up the wall, and so we even get mad at our own family members. And what about road rage? I tell you, that is something that we get real impatient about. On Family Feud, which I love that show, they mentioned when you're in traffic, what is the number one thing that you do? Well, the number one answer was that we sometimes say things that we shouldn't, and we are screaming within our own cars when we are in long line. I'm sure glad, as I always said, when we go to Chicago, Liscombe looks pretty good. We don't have very much traffic problems. I always say what you call four cars in Liscombe, a traffic jam. That's what I always call about Liscombe. But it's a lot different than Chicago. So we lose our impatience even on the road. And also we become even impatient with ourselves. And don't we? We get pretty mad sometimes. We have to be patient, tells us. God is patient. Christ is the patient Savior. He was patient with the apostles and his servants down through the years. And Christ wants us to be patient with other people as well. Let me quote four men, or at least three men here, that describes patience. Vance Hafner said, "He who waits on God loses no time." Isn't that great? Also, another famous quote, "To be patient with God because things are not to our liking makes a Christian life a dreadful burden." Okay, so we're all just asking for trouble if we just become impatient. We shouldn't become impatient with God. He is all-knowing. He knows what to do in your life at the right time. So we shouldn't become impatient with God. We hear it in the Bible about "go ye," but sometimes we pass over the section that says "to tarry ye." And we preach about urgency, not about patience. And also it says in Psalms 27:14 in the King James, it says, "O tarry not, O tarry thou in the Lord's leisure." I like that one. And it says that we should wait upon the Lord. I think about the farmer. Now, the farmer has to be patient. Well, he has to wait 6 months for his crops as well. He plants in April and May, and he has to wait clear to October to get his crops. But I think about the animals. A chicken farmer has to wait at least 3 months for his chickens to become of age so they can sell them and so they can butcher the chickens. I know that one of my jobs was on the farm, I had to cut the head off the heads of roosters. And it is true that the expression, "he runs around like a chicken with his head cut off," that is true, I can tell you that. I used to put a log chain over the neck and I had to chop it off. I didn't have to pluck it, I was thankful for that. But you have to wait 3 months to have a finished product for a chicken. Also, hogs, about 6 months. Now, I asked Ron all these, so if I'm incorrect, you can blame Ron. Okay, so I called him on the hogs, and definitely he knows that it takes about 6 months to have a finished project for a hog. And a cattle farmer, about a year and a half to basically 2 years, that's a long wait to get your money back on your investment. It's a good thing that we don't raise elephants. Did you realize that it takes 2 years from gestation period for birth, it's 2 years for an elephant. Now, I would go up to some of the ladies when they were pregnant, and boy, they were really anxious to have the baby, and I would say to them, it's a good thing you're not an elephant, because you have to wait 2 years. That went over not too good. They told me to pack my trunk and leave. That's pretty wrong. When it comes to women and the 9 months that they had to wait. But we are impatient. What did we do before the microwave ovens? I mean, now you just put it in there and boy, you got hot coffee and warm meat and warm vegetables. What did we do before the microwave? And as a preacher, I know it's really tough to hold the audience attention. About 20 to 25 minutes, I guess we'll sit out. I've learned that. They always say a good sermon is a good introduction and a good conclusion and not too far in between. That's pretty well what I've learned about patience. But we're supposed to be patient. God will bless us if we are patient. Let's go on to the second point. Christian love is always kind. Jesus is kind in all kinds of circumstances. If we are to be truly loving, we must have a lifestyle of kindness. It has been said that kindness is a language the deaf can hear and the blind can see. I like that. Let me say it again. Kindness is a language in which the deaf can hear and the blind can see. Love does kind things. What kind of thing that, what have you done lately to show the loving God relationship and that you are kind to others? It says in the Bible, be ye kind. And he expects us to be kind people. There was a policeman in Las Vegas. When this man was shooting the people, 59 dead and 500 injured, there was a policeman that had been on the job only 2 days. He went right in the midst of that crowd and started helping people. And he's in the hospital right now because of his bravery and his kindness to other people. He was visited in the hospital and he says he can't wait to get well so that he can go about his duties of helping people. Now there was a man that was very kind. He has the love of God within him, knowing what kindness is all about. Be ye kind is one of the first verses, probably, Danette. That's a good one for Danette as far as just simple, but so important. Be ye kind. I know I preached a whole sermon on be ye kind one time. That's important. But it's a lot easier to quote that verse than to always be kind to others that have hurt us. A family bought a brand new television set. And they were so excited to get the antenna. Remember when you had to put up the antenna? And there was a new guy in the neighborhood that they had a little open house, and he found out that they needed a little help. So he brought over his tool set, and his tool set was magnificent. They weren't getting very far in getting this antenna, but he came with his new tools, and he put that antenna up, and nothing flat. And they were so excited that he came over to help them. And they said, well, what do you make with these tools that are so great? And he looked at them sincerely, well, most of all, I make friends. And that's exactly what our talent should be. We should make friends with our talents that God has given us. And that is the greatest thing that we can have, our relationship with God and our friends in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why I look forward every Sunday to coming and being here, because I love to greet my Christian friends. And that should be our greatest goal in life as well, just to come to church and share and to love those that are your friends in Christ Jesus. Look at Jesus' life and how kind he was. He had kindness at a wedding in which he changed the water into wine. Also the widow of Nain. We think of the crowds that he fed. There was two different occasions. He fed 4,000 people at one time. There was even more than that, because that was just the men, not counting the women and the children. And then the feeding of the 5,000 as well. So he cares about the individual cares of his people as well. Think how kind he was. When he was on the cross, he asked that somebody take care of his mother. And also the thief on the cross asked for forgiveness, and he gave him forgiveness, and he said, on this day you will be in paradise with me. That's the kind of lifestyle that Jesus lived. He was kind and everywhere. He cared for people. And that's why so many people came to hear him preach, and that's why people wanted to be around him, because he was so very, very kind. It also says that, the third point, that Christian love bears up under everything. The New English Bible defines it this way: there is nothing love cannot base. Another translator declares that love knows no limit to endurance. Love carries the burdens of others cheerfully. I think the key to that statement is to look on the good side of people rather than the bad side. I think we all have a side which we don't like to have people look on. We're so glad that when people don't pick out our faults and just nail us. Maybe you've had somebody like that just, maybe you have a fault, and boy, it's hard to be friends with some people that just remind you of your faults. We must look on the good side of people, because there's a lot of good in a lot of people. Yes, we all have our faults, but I think the key to bearing love is to look on the good side of people. Love can overlook the faults of others, which is the key factor in a good marriage. God sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. Now that's not John 3:16, that is John 3:17. And sometimes I think we overlook John 3:17 because we always quote John 3:16 all the time. But they need to go together. They need to go together, because I love that he came into the world not to condemn the world, but that through him we might be saved. Perhaps, as I said, this is such an important aspect of John 3:16 and 17. I love this song. It's a contemporary song. It's called Jesus, Friend of Sinners. That's really a neat song, that he really does care for sinners, and he has saved us from our sin. In our marriage vows, now how long has it been now, Casey, since you've been married now?
Next month it'll be, or not, 2 months.
2 months, okay. Okay, notice I didn't ask Brandon on that. Okay. Women are better than that. Okay, but anyway, one of the things that I've always said is the traditional vows, that to have and to hold from this day forth, for better for worse, for richer for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish till death parts us. You know, there's a lot of vows that are being changed in the traditional wedding vows. They change it to as long as we are in love. And how sad that is, that we're supposed to love to the very end. And that should be our goal in the Christian faith as well, to have the Christ love for others till we die as well. True love never gives up. It carries the burdens in relationship and overlooks faults. This is so true in our own Christian life as well. In closing, I'm going to have this illustration here, and I think it really speaks well. A husband and wife discussing old times, when the husband said, "My dear, I have taken you safely over the rough spots of life. And she said, yes, dear, you have. And I don't think you've missed one of them. Well, I guess that's what love is all about, isn't it? That we love, and also for better, for worse. That is true love. And I think that we can all look at our marriage and say, there have been tough times, but we have stood the test of time through the help of our Lord Jesus Christ. Christian love is never an accident, nor is it automatic. It is made possible by the love of God and revealed in Christ Jesus for each one of us. Remember what I said from the very beginning of the scriptures? We are made in the image of God. And when we don't love, then we're out of sync. We really are. He expects us to love just as He has loved. And it's so neat that we said that we forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us, which we talked about in our Sunday school lesson. God has so freely forgiven us, we need to forgive others. Then we know what true love is all about. I'm asking you, what kind thing will you do this week to show your love? We are expected to be kind in the home. We are expected to be kind at school. And that's not always easy. We talk about bullying all the time. There's always someone that tries to bully his way over us. And that's been talked a lot. And that is not the kind of love that Christ expects of each of us. You need to be kind in your job as well. Every place you go, people can actually say of you, I really like that person. He is so kind. Hopefully, that is said of you as you walk down the street or wherever you go. That person is really kind. Let us respond to God's love as it flows through you, and may you be a blessing to all.